Hello, everybody, and welcome to this year's talk on modern front-end development. I say this year because, as you will see in the first slide, we have some screenshots of previous talk about this topic. And this is the fourth year that we are talking about enhancing front-end development in Liferay. This is because we are engaged in a continuous effort to make front-end development easier in Liferay, and also we're trying to isolate front-end developers from the specifics of the platform and trying to adapt our development workflows to the standard expectations of front-end developers. So if you see here in 2015, we included support for ECMAScript 6 with the advent of Babel tool. Then next year, in 2016, we included the AMD loader so that you can build modular applications with JavaScript. And last year, we introduced the bundler, the tool that allows you to deploy NPM packages to the Liferay portal. With this, we are approaching a very standard workflow when it comes to front-end development. So we will structure this talk as we did with the others. We will see three blocks. The first block, we will explain what we had last year available. Then we will have a block explaining what limitations we found, or you found, when using these features. And then a third block explaining how we have implemented new enhancements to overcome these limitations. I will also do a demo so that you can see it working live. So let's start with what we had. Last year we had a flexible platform, you know it, Liferay DXP, with lots of built-in functionalities that you can use in your developments, like content management, publishing, social, all the tools you already know. So because we have this flexible platform, which is very powerful, we think that it adds value to deploy your front-end developments on top of this platform. There are some more options that some people talk about them in the conference and in the workshop this morning, which could be, for example, making a single web application and accessing Liferay through headless APIs. That's also a valid setup, but you lose a lot of things. These things, authorization, and all this kind of stuff. So we think it is much better to deploy on top of Liferay. Okay. So on top of this platform, last year we had the support for the NPM packages deployment. So we had development of portlets using NPM and Gradle tools, deployment of these packages, and some infrastructure which consisted of the AMD loader and some other stuff that we did last year to make portlets cooperate between them when it comes to rendering the page. If you have several portlets in a page and all of them are using different NPM packages, you need some way for them to cooperate and don't fight between them if they are deploying several frameworks or several different libraries. Okay. So we provided some functionality to achieve that. So to remember how this worked, because some people may have not been in last year's talk, we're going to show these slides, which are from last year's presentation, which explain how this worked. So we have a developer who decides to create a front-end project. He uses NPM to download packages from the NPM registry and downloads them to the local machine and starts to do the portlet development, the front-end development, in maybe writing some tests, coding, hacking, all these things. And in some moment, he decides to deploy this portlet to Liferay. So in this moment is when the developer has to use our tools, which were Gradle and the bundler. The bundler took responsibility for processing all the NPM packages and format them so that they can be registered in the server and served to the browser. And Gradle was responsible for compiling the Java class that defined the portlet and for creating a jar file that could be deployed to the server. That jar file is an OSGI bundle, and when it is deployed to Liferay, it is processed by two pieces. One is the portlet tracker that read the Java class that Gradle generated and instantiated a portlet, and then the npm processor scanned all the files that the bundler prepared and registered them in a special piece that we call npm registry. So that when the user opens a browser and hits that portlet, the portlet gets rendered with the JavaScript and the HTML files, and the JavaScript in some moment invokes the required system call, which is provided by our loader, AMD loader, and the loader will grab all the npm packages from the server and will make them work. Okay, so this was the initial setup. This initial setup had some limitations, as I said, in three different sections. One was development, another was deployment, and integration. Regarding development, because we were using backend and frontend tools, this setup required some Liferay-specific knowledge. In particular, it required backend and frontend knowledge. So it required like kind of a mixed role developer, a full stack developer or someone who knew both things. So this is not very usual in companies. So we decided that if we were going to deploy to develop frontend portlets, we will try to make front tools. Regarding deployment, because again, you have two tools, Gradle, one is Java-based and the other is JavaScript-based, the bundler. This required a complex configuration, more complex than if you only had one tool, because you have to make two different tools from two different worlds cooperate together to create an artifact. And finally, when it comes to integration, we had a method of deduplication of npm packages, which was too aggressive. The deduplication concept, what it does is, because we are deploying portlets, not single web application, but portlets, and we can have several portlets inside the same page. Imagine what will happen if you deploy five portlets using React. You wouldn't want to have five copies of React in the browser. You would want to have just one copy so that it doesn't affect performance and it doesn't load the browser too much. So for that to work, we had some deduplication code in the platform that made this available, but it was too aggressive. So if you had one portlet with, say, React, I'm inventing the version, but say you have portlet depending on React 4.3 and another one depending on React 4.1, the platform would detect that both were compatible and would point the portlet using React 4.1 to React 4.3 without the developer doing anything. This is just because you have deployed two portlets in Liferay and one of them is using a newer version. The one with the older version got its version replaced. But this is bypassing all the development cycle, because the developer was developing with the older version, was testing with the older version. He was probably integrating and doing user acceptance test with the old version. And now when it comes to deployment, we, without letting him control anything, we are swapping the version. So this is kind of a problem. It may work, but it also may fail. So this was a limitation. This is more complex than this. We made three blog posts that are available in blogs.liferay.com. The first one explaining what was the problem in depth, because it's more complex than what I have explained now. A second post telling how we are fixing this problem, and a third one with a real-life example of an Angular application using this new solution, okay, where you can see how it interacts and what it does. So let's see what's new and how we overcome these limitations. To overcome these limitations, we attack 2 points. One, we made some enhancements to dependency handling. For that, we need to create we needed to create a new bundler called Bundler 2. So now we have two bundlers: Bundler Series version 1 and Bundler 2, which uses the new dependency handling. We encourage you to use Bundler 2 for everything, but they are still compatible what they generate. We also made the duplication thing configurable using the concept of imports. And because we were already changing the bundler, we decided to do a pure JavaScript tooling, okay, so that you don't need Gradle anymore. And you don't need Java installed. So let's see this in detail. Let's see how we do the new dependency handling. This slide shows the difference between Bundler 1 and Bundler 2. Bundler 1 had this concept of global namespace, where all NPM packages that you deployed lived in the same namespace. So if you had one copy of React for 2, it was the same copy for all the portlets. No matter what you did or what you tried, all portlets using React for 2 will use that copy. There was no other way to use separate copies or sandbox or isolate any portlet. That's because the resolution strategy, as I say, was not modifiable or configurable. Okay, so what we did in Bundler 2 was deconstructing this aggressive deduplication and, first of all, making it work like Webpack does. So now, if you create a portlet with Bundler 2, all its dependencies are isolated and are used by that portlet. So if I deploy one portlet with React for 2 and another with React for 1, each one uses its own copy of React. This is better because it's predictable and you don't introduce spurious changes. On the other hand, you have lost all the duplication. So if you deploy 5 portlets, you have 5 copies of React. So for that to work, we need to introduce another concept, okay, which is the imports concept. We will see the imports concept in a minute. But now we're going to see what the bundler generates to achieve this magic isolation, because it's not so difficult as it seems at the beginning. These are two pieces of code. One is generated by Bundler 1, and the other is generated by Bundler 2. This is what you get when the bundler processes your NPM packages. When the bundler processes an NPM package, it wraps everything in a loader-defined call, which is the registration call for our loader, so that the loader knows that this module exists, and then it gets an array with all the dependencies. So as you see here in Bundler 1, we had a dependency of Angular core that in Bundler 2 is prefixed with myproject $. Myproject is the name of your project. So that way, you are using the Angular core that you have in your project, not the global one. Okay? So with this little change in the code, without changing anything in the server, we didn't need to put anything extra in the server, we allowed to use local dependencies with Bundler 2. And we will see how can we achieve imports in a moment, and how easy it is with this prefixing. If you have a look at the inside of the jar file generated with the bundler, you will see that we have prefixed dependencies, but we have also renamed all the packages that you downloaded from node modules, adding the myproject prefix, and we have also rewritten all package.json files. So that everything gets dependencies from local portlet. So now, when we come to the duplication, we need to configure imports. In this case, what we are going to do is, instead of deploying two portlets like before and letting the platform decide how to deduplicate things, we are going to do it by hand. So we will be able to deploy one portlet and one shared bundle which is not a portlet, but it's an OSGI bundle that will provide React in this case. And we will point the portlet to use that React instead of its own React. This way, we can deploy as many shared bundles as we want. We can deploy, for example, React 4, React 3, and React 2, and have two portlets pointing to React 2, some other portlets to React 3, whatever you need. So now it's your responsibility to decide how to change these dependencies. Okay. So to configure an import is as easy as writing a package JSON. As I said, this is an example. Imagine that this is consumer is a project which contains a portlet, and provider is the shared bundle that I said that is going to pack, in this case Angular only, to deploy it to Liferay. So you have a provider, you have some dependencies, which is the whole Angular, and then build this, deploy it to Liferay, and it is made available, Angular is made available to the loader just because you have deployed that. And then you go to your portlet projects, and in the npm bundler rc file, which is the configuration file for the bundler, you only have to add a config imports section and list all the Angular dependencies under a special section, in this case, Angular provider, which is the ID of the provider. And this is telling the bundler to grab Angular from the provider, not from myself. And to implement this is as easy as changing the prefix. When the bundler comes to preprocess your npm packages, just because you are importing Angular core from the provider, instead of prefixing it with my project, it prefixes it with provider. And just this little change makes this module grab the dependency from the provider when it comes to runtime. Okay. So, next section. That's all about dependency handling. The other enhancement is pure JavaScript development. This is something that we wanted to have since long ago, but we didn't have the maturity to implement it yet. So this year, finally, we have it, and this is why this girl is so excited about this development. Okay, so the basic components of this workflow, of this pure JavaScript workflow, are similar to last year's workflow, but removing Java from the equation. Okay, so we still have package management based on npm because it was already front-end and it's the standard tool, but instead of using Blade, last year we had Blade, which is a Java tool that generates skeletons of projects, but you need a JDK to run it, and it generated Java code. We have created a pure JavaScript geoman generator. Okay, so we have a geoman generator that creates your portlet projects for you to continue working on them. And then, because we couldn't rely on Gradle, we had to add some functionality to the bundler to make it output jar files. So, how would this work? We're going to see this in the demo, but we see it in the slide. You just call the generator. It's a command line tool that, as Brian said in his presentation, he likes it a lot because it's command line. So. And it asks some question, it generates the project. Then, when it comes to building the project, you just run npm run build, which is an npm script, no Gradle anymore, and that generates a jar file that, with npm run deploy, can be deployed to the server. Okay. So, how does the resulting jar file look like? Because we don't have Gradle, we cannot compile Java. And because we cannot compile Java, we cannot include a class to describe the portlet inside the jar file. So we have to do some other thing. That other thing is adding an extra header in the manifest of the jar file, which you see there in red, which is a required capability, and it says extender Liferay frontend JS portlet. This is a special module that we'll see in a moment, that processes this type of jar files and creates portlets on the fly. without you needing to write any Java class. But because you don't have a Java class, you cannot annotate the portlet, and you cannot say which properties the portlet has. So for that, we have created a new section in package.json where you can specify under portlet all the standard portlet properties that are defined in the spec, in the portlet spec and in our spec library, which can be the name, the role refs, and the CSS style use, everything, all this stuff. So that when you deploy that jar file, this new piece, which is named JS Portlet Extender, this is an OSGI module that is available in the marketplace, and you can install in your library server. And it will take your jar file, will process it, and will generate an automatic portlet. This automatic portlet will have your JavaScript files, all the static assets that you included, and a generated HTML. This HTML is empty, of course, because this is automatic. But it has a div tag with a specific ID. That specific ID will be given to your JavaScript code so that you can generate a user interface inside this HTML with your framework choice, React, Angular, whatever. So for that to happen, we need to give you some contract. So the contract is that the main module of your project, the one that you specify in the main section of package.json, must export a single function, a default function, that receives a single argument, which is an update with these three fields. These three fields are given by the Liferay extender to you, and they contain the portlet namespace, the unique namespace, as it is defined in the specification, the context path, which is the URL from where you can fetch static resources that you are including, like images, CSS, or whatever, and the most important argument is portlet element ID, which is the ID of the div tag where you have to render your user interface. Okay. So let's see a demo. I have a Liferay server started in the other tab, and I'm going to call the generator. So the generator asks what type of portlet I want to create. I will create a React one. He asks for the name of the project, the description, under which category I want to list this project. He asks if I have a Liferay installation. I say yes, and where it is. And if I want to generate some sample code, of course I want, because we want to show something in the server. So if I go to my editor, we can see here all the files that are being generated by Geoman. We can see that it has generated a README with the description, a package.json, which includes React, some build scripts, and the portlet section that I said, and the index.js entry point. If we come to index.js, we can see the function that I said, and it renders a React component, passing these three parameters and attaching it to the portlet element ID. And finally, this React component just prints the properties that were passed by the Liferay extender. So if we now do npm run deploy, had to change to the folder. So if I run npm run deploy, this is going to generate the jar and copy it to our Liferay instance. The first time it takes some time because it has to process all the React stuff. But next builds, instead of taking 12 seconds, just take milliseconds. So if we go to Tomcat, it will detect that we have deployed a new portlet. And if I come here to the home page and refresh, I will have a new portlet available here under sample, which is my project. So if I add this to the page, this is the portlet being rendered. Imagine that I want to change something here. I can say hello world. I save it, I deploy it again, but instead of taking 12 seconds, it's going to take 300 milliseconds. The server is going to detect the change, and we will see the change here. Okay. We think this is more or less fast, but we understand that some people may want to have live reloads. So we have provided a new experimental target, which is npm run start. And what this does is starting a Webpack development server in port 8081 and renders the portlet. The same as you render here, it is rendered here. Of course, you are not inside Liferay, so you don't have access to any API. So this has its limitation. But this is the first version, as I said, is experimental. And we want your feedback to know what you need and see how can we push this more to make it more useful. But I was trying to show the live reload. So if I say this immediately refresh, okay. That's it. Let me show you. Let me show you some places where you can find more information on this topic. The central point of information is the npm build tools project. This is in GitHub, in Liferay organization, and it is called Liferay npm build tools. And for now, we are using the wiki as the central point, the central entry point of you as developers. And we have documentation with wiki entries and links to external resources. For example, you can get the links to the blog post I said in the first slides and to some other useful resources like last year's talk about this topic and all these things. Also, there is the issues tab where you can create bugs and questions. Or if you don't know if it is a bug or a question, just file something there and we will try to ask and to answer and see if it is a question or a bug. Or the idea is to have all your questions listed there because we have them tagged and there is a link in the wiki so that later we can query these questions and see if someone had the same problem and if it was resolved or not. Some kind of like a knowledge base, something like that. And of course, you have the official documentation in devliferay.com, where you have articles explaining how to create portlets from scratch and, well, the official documentation. And to finish with, we have the community Slack. All those of you who are not yet in the community Slack, I encourage you to create a user there and have a look at the Slack. And in particular, in the front-end channel, we can resolve any issues that you have, and you can get feedback from some other people in the community or discuss things, ask questions, whatever, or try to get help. Well, that's it. Please rate this session. Hope that you like it. There is not too much time available, so if you need to make any question, I will be in the hall. So you can go after me and ask me any question or any doubt you have. Thanks.
All right. So as he said,